Welcome back to Native Honor Hours. It's been quite a while since we've been back on the air. My name is Ed Zendejas.
My name is Cindy Kraftka.
And as I said before, it's been a while. We took a little hiatus.
Are you in the hallowed halls of justice in Macy?
I'm sitting in a pretty dark and stuffy place right now. But anyway, it's good to be back. A lot of stuff has happened since we've been away.
Yep.
There's a lot of cool legal stuff going on. I don't know if I'm going to bore too many people with what's happening in the Supreme Court, but it might be worth a mention. But some other things going on. You got stuff for us? First, you want to give a shout out to Brother Gary?
Hey, happy birthday, Gary. If you were here, we'd have made you a cake.
Yeah, I wouldn't have eaten it because I'm trying to avoid carbs.
I thought about you. I made chocolate chip cookies and I was going to bring them to dinner. And I thought, nope, better not. You could even walk away from homemade chocolate chip cookies.
Yeah, I could.
Wow.
I have been. But anyway, like I said, there's been a lot of things going on.
I'd like to start out with a small, short discussion on gun control. If what we learn is we are all related, we've lost a lot of grandchildren due to
I don't know if I want to say, I'll throw this up there. Here where I preside over a judicial system, we have a constitution on reservations, and it's like this throughout most reservations, that there's no equivalent to the Second Amendment. So the tribes can ban weapons, they can regulate weapons how they see fit, because it's not a constitutional right on a reservation, and that's pursuant to the Indian Civil Rights Act. So if I'm just thinking, if tribes can do it, if we can get by without then I guess the critics would say, yeah, that's why the government was able to take all your land, you didn't have guns. But in many instances, that was a provision of treaties, is that, you know, that we had to disarm ourselves, and but you know, we figured it out, and I don't know, I'm tired, like most of the country is, of hearing a lot of noise about, well, you know, it's not this, it's not that. Yeah, we know what it is. We're just tired of the inaction. So I hope,
tired of losing children and grandchildren. Did it ever occur to you one day of your life when our children were growing up that we had to worry about them being shot in school, in a mall, in a movie, in a grocery store? Did it ever once occur to you?
Well, I would say this, and you know, most people say, well, you can't touch your guns. Yeah, you can. If you look at the Second Amendment, it has the word regulated in there. So if you want to talk about the original intent of the Constitution, doesn't say that you have, you know, there's even doubt as to whether that applied to individuals, or it said well-regulated militia. So
that's not what some of these groups are saying they are. They're saying there are regulated militias.
No, they're not. But anyway, I'm hopeful. No, I'm not hopeful. You know, I've looked at some of the things that they're proposing. It really doesn't amount to much. But
no, it doesn't. And it doesn't even stand a very good chance of passing the Senate as it is. You have to be 21 to have a drink, but 18 to buy an assault rifle. Some guy posted that he needs his to kill prairie dogs. What? You need an assault rifle to kill prairie dogs? Excuse me.
You know, I'm not opposed to somebody, you know, having a weapon. I just think there needs to be one more firmly regulated against assault rifles, and some type of regulate. I mean, I'm just tired of the inaction, most of all. You know, this happens frequently when we have these types of shootings, is that people get, rightfully so, get upset, but yet nothing comes out of Congress. So,
well, how are things going to change when we have gubernatorial candidates posing with guns? How are things going to change? I personally will never vote for a candidate for anything that I see holding a gun in an ad. What I don't understand is why every mother in America is not coming forward and saying, we want responsible gun laws. You change or we're going to vote. And that's what it really all boils down to, voting. Every American has a say in the government, and you have to vote to have that say. If you don't like seeing your candidate or a candidate for governor standing with a gun, vote the other way.
Gretchen's got a comment.
What's her comment?
Who does?
Gretchen said, it's sad to hear my 7-year-old grandson tell me about his active shooter drills at school.
I know my daughter tells me about, you know, my grandkids that are, you know, frightened when they hear things like that. So I totally understand that.
You know what? In our generation, though, we had drills for nuclear or being bombed. Do you remember those? Did you have those drills, Ed?
Yes, I did.
We did. It was get under your desk because, you know, that's going to protect. But we had those drills.
We're going to be safe from that nuclear fallout underneath our desks.
Oh. You know, that was what scared our parents, but that wasn't here. And we all knew it wasn't going to happen. At least we hoped. Now, every time you say goodbye to your kid, it could be the last time. My grandsons are in high school in Lincoln, and they had 2 active shooter occurrences in the school. They got 2 kids with guns that had plans to do it. So it's
there's a lot of knuckleheads of the week awards that we can dole out on an issue, but shall we move on to something maybe a little bit more lighter in terms of what's going on in the entertainment world for natives? We have a new show that just started up that
Dark
I Winds. Haven't seen yet.
Dark Winds.
Dark Winds.
Starring Zahn McLaren. It's a Tony Hillerman mystery set on the Dene Reservation. And I watched the first episode. It was excellent.
Well, it was taped, so I'll go back and look at it. But
are you still using the VCR taping machine?
No, it's on our little thing. I know how to click the, and I can figure that out.
Well, it's excellent. You know, it shows it's oddly reminiscent of Dances with Wolves in a strangely bizarre way.
Well, coming up soon is more episodes of Brother Gary in Resident Alien.
Really? When does that start again? Before we go on, let's just say Dark Winds is on AMC or AMC Plus. Resident Alien. Resident Alien is on the Sci-Fi Channel or FX or Hulu, and Rutherford Falls is on the Peacock Channel.
I have to admit, I haven't seen Rutherford Falls.
Oh my God, I can't believe you of all people, because it is 100% sarcastic humor, and it's to the point where a white guy says, you don't understand how it feels to be persecuted. The Indian girl just looks at him. It's humor like that. They're turning things on their head. Michael Gray Eyes is in it. I can't think of the lead girl's name, but she was on a talk show last night talking about Native representation in films. So when in our history have we ever had 3 shows with Native Americans running simultaneously without being shot at by John Wayne?
Counting Reservation Dogs.
Huh?
I'm not even counting Reservation Dogs.
Is that a fall show?
I don't know when it's. You know, anymore they don't run on the traditional schedule. They do all kinds of goofy things. Else, you just have to watch. I'm sure there'll be plenty of memes. You know, when Reservation Dogs comes out, so everybody will let everybody else know. But not too worried about it.
I think it's so far Dark Winds is great. Zahn, and you know, Zahn's an Omaha boy, went to Central High. I think it's kind of funny that they have a Lakota playing a Dene.
Yeah, you know, that seems to be his I don't want to say typecast, but he's always law enforcement.
You know what? If you would have seen, and I know you wouldn't because you don't like horror stories, but Stephen King's follow-up to The Shining was called, oh my gosh, now I can't even think about it. But Zahn is with the bad guys. And let me tell you, he plays crazy really good.
Well, most of the TV series he's been on, he's played a cop or some type of law enforcement.
It's antithetic to all that is native.
He's on the other,
did you see Chris Ayer
side directing of the law.
Chris Ayer is directing it, who was, oh yeah, that's right, at our film festival.
Yeah, so there's a lot of things. I mean, how often have we ever had the opportunity to say that? There's a lot of choices for, you know, Native entertainment this summer.
Brother Gary seems to be doing well. He's on Resident Alien. He's on Res Dogs. Who knows where he'll show up next? Where, oh, where is Gary going?
Yeah, you're supposed to keep track of that.
I give up.
I thought that was your job.
I give up. I did wish him happy birthday, did you?
He knows.
You two have unagi.
Yeah. But I also wanted to talk a little bit about the Genoa Indian School.
Yeah.
You want to take that up?
From what I understand, some cadaver-sniffing dogs potentially have found some of the bones of these kids. So here's my question, Ed. What do they do with the bones? How do you know what tribe they go home to? What do you do with the remains of these children?
Well, I think
when they're in graves, when they've been washed away, where it's going to just be a...
I think the first step is to verify that they found something. I saw the video on that, and it was a dog that, a cadaver-sniffing dog, and I don't know how accurate this dog has been, but, you know, they show the film of the dog sort of running around and hitting a spot and then, you know, sort of sitting there, and I guess we'll find out, but...
We should do a remote show from there.
I don't know if I'm going to hold out, hope that that's the case.
But, would Genoa let us in with cameras, do you think?
What's that?
Would Genoa let us in with cameras? I think we ought to do a distant show from Genoa.
No, we need to take some drones there that have those ultrasonic cameras and see if it's... I don't even know, Kenny. I'm just making stuff up.
You know, here's the thing. I watch a lot of those shows. And yes, there is ground penetrating radar, is what they call it. And you don't even need drones. You go over it with this machine. I learned all of this on The Secrets of Skinwalker Ranch. You go over it with machine and it plots what is going on underground. They did it with the Mayan ruins. They're doing it with a lot of things. So there is the technology to do this. I assume it's expensive, but this sounds like something that somebody would want to fund.
Well, you know, they have their yearly, I don't know, they used to call it a reunion.
But yep.
It's in August. I don't know if you want to go up there this August or not.
I think it would be a great idea because, first of all, I would like to see who shows up. I'd like to see if any of the actual boarding school families of the people who went there would show up. My little brother was involved with the Carlisle return.
They used to have quite a bit. I mean, I don't say quite a bit. They used to have, there's no actual living residents of the boarding school, but they had descendants. And they have one family that funds a scholarship for anyone who's a descendant of the boarding schools. So I know they show up every year, but I imagine
aren't we all descendants of the boarding schools?
What's that?
Aren't we all descendants of the boarding schools? I don't know very many people my age whose parents and grandparents were not in the boarding schools. including some of my friends. Donnell Keeler, our dear friend, was in the boarding school. My mom, Laura Lemire, her family.
I have relatives that were at the Carlisle boarding school. As well.
Why don't you do one of those TED Talks on the boarding schools?
You know, I still would like to teach that class again.
You know, Ed, you opened my eyes. You really, really did. And in a way, even though my mom was already dead, you helped me to understand who she was and to forgive her for a lot of things and to see that a lot of it wasn't my fault, that it was what happened to my mom. Until I took your class, I had no idea, because we don't talk about it. Nobody in my family talks about the boarding school experience or ever did when they were alive and we were young. So after I took your class, it kind of was an awakening for me and under a deeper understanding of who my mom was and where she came from.
Well, I think that class was valuable for a lot of reasons. One was, I think for those of us that, you know, that had ancestors attend these boarding schools to get a better sense of what their lives were like and how the boarding school shaped how they were as adults. The other part of it was that it's a part of history that, as we know, is not taught very often, if at all. But it's an opportunity for us to shed some light on that era and what happened. And I think light that we can shine on that, the better.
For anybody who's going to work with Native peoples or on the reservations, it's good to understand the boarding schools, because then you understand the mistrust of education. Then you understand the mistrust of the government. Then you understand the mistrust of religions. If you're going to go work with Natives and you don't have that fundamental understanding, you're going to have a hard time in Indian country, because you don't understand where these people came from and why they are the way they are.
Well, hopefully, maybe one of these days I'll.
Well, I'm going to investigate how to get on a TED Talk. But please don't wear your vest. If I get you a TED Talk, you may not wear your vest.
I haven't worn a vest in a long time.
Me and Kenny discussed that earlier. We wondered if you were going to show up in your vest.
You know what? I still have them, though.
I know you do. I know you do. I used to equate you to Cosby, but I don't do that anymore.
But when the time's right, I might break it out.
Oh, please, take a photo with you.
There's a lot of things happening in the Supreme Court right now that are having a huge impact in Indian country.
Well, before we get into that, because I really want to hear it, I would like to ask if anybody has heard anything about Dev Holland and how she did with COVID.
Did she get it?
Yes. I was sad to read that she tested positive for COVID. And I really haven't heard much since. So our hopes are that she's doing well, and we send our best wishes and hopes for a speedy recovery. We need Deb Holland now. Okay, Supreme Court me, Your Lordship.
Well, there are two cases that were just announced this past week. It's sort of there was a big win for tribes yesterday, at least specifically two tribes in Texas. And that's important, I think, because it had to do with gaming, and it had to do with here's what happened. It was two tribes. One of them is Sleda Pueblo. The other one is the Cachada tribe. And they signed, in order to be recognized again as tribes, Texas had to sign on, and they said, all right, we'll agree to let you be a tribe again, but you have to comply with the state of Texas gaming laws. In Texas, they authorized bingo, but only for limited nonprofit purposes like churches.
Bingo.
And, so what the two tribes did is they said, all right, we're going to go with, you know, the Cabazon case, which governs throughout Indian country, where it says if a state allows a certain type of gaming activity but regulates it, then the tribes can game without those state regulations. And if they prohibit it, I mean, if they say you can't do it, then you can't do it. That's how come in Nebraska we couldn't do slot machines on Indian reservations, because Nebraska forbid it. But we can do other types of things like, you know, bingo and lottery, that kind of thing.
Didn't I see Lance Morgan just post that they got theirs?
Well, that's a different area. Lance Morgan, their new venture is being operated under state law. It's not under tribal law at all.
Okay.
So there's a difference. But these tribes in Texas were saying, all right, well, we're going to do bingo and we're going to high stakes. We're going to do whatever they want to do. And Texas, of course, was upset with that because they said, you have to follow our laws, and our laws only allow bingo for a certain nonprofit, you know, churches kind of thing. And they had a case in the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals that affirmed that and said that these tribes couldn't do it. But the tribes, you know, they went on and continued to do it anyway, got a temporary injunction against it. And the Supreme Court had heard the case of whether Texas law applied and essentially banned them from playing bingo, or if the Cabazon, you know, line of cases, you know, was valid, and then that the tribes can do it if the states authorize it but try to limit it. And in Gorsuch wrote the opinion, and he said, yes, you know, the tribes can do that. We're going to follow what the, you know, the law was. And you have to, Gorsuch did such a great job of spanking Texas verbally. It was fun to read. And what was interesting about it, and the reason why this may be, there's a couple goofy things going on, and I hope I make sense when I say this. It was a 5-4 decision. It was, Breyer, Kagan, Sotomayor, and Gorsuch. But the fifth one was Amy Coney Barrett that went along with Gorsuch in this case, which stunned me. I was shocked, because the previous, you know, case that was just released, I think on Monday, it dealt with whether there was a double jeopardy case in Indian country. And she wrote the majority opinion that held that that it wasn't double jeopardy, that the guy that was tried in what's called a CFR court still represented a separate sovereign from the U.S. But, and Gorsuch wrote the dissent in that case. And he was, Gorsuch knows his stuff when it comes to Indian law. And
why do you think that is?
Because he was out in the West. He's out in, comes from Colorado area, where there were a lot of cases that they had to decide. Most of these Supreme Court justices come from the East Coast, and rarely do they get any Indian law experience or cases that come before them. But what was interesting about this, and hopefully I make my point here, is that in one instance, you know, Judge Barrett, you know, essentially went up against, you know, Gorsuch, and Gorsuch wrote a really compelling dissent. But on the other case, dealing with the Texas case, you know, she cited, was the only one of the conservative blocks outside of Gorsuch to, you know, to sign on to this case, which I was stunned. It was just incredible to me that she would do that. And then the reason why that's significant is that there's another, that we've talked about this, an Indian Child Welfare Act case that's coming out of Texas that essentially would gut the Indian Child Welfare Act if if the Supreme Court goes that route. And I'm pretty sure that it's going to be a 5-4, and Gorsuch is either going to write the majority or the dissent. And I'm hopeful that he could get. I don't know if Roberts is going to do it, but if Barrett would sign on to another one of Gorsuch's, if he's compelling enough, that I'm hopeful that she'll listen. But I don't know. It's still up in the air, and we should know within the next week or so what's going to happen with that case. And
how much do they stick with precedents? Say, for instance, the Indian Child Welfare Act. Precedents has been set for that case. How much do they follow that? Or because you can't look at the Constitution, because basically we're chattel in the Constitution.
No, as we have come to find out with the Roe versus Wade sort of controversy, there are a number of justices that are aching to overturn various cases or various laws and previous precedent. And
I'm sorry, but I thought Supreme Court judges were supposed to follow the letter of the law, not their personal political beliefs.
Well, it goes on to, they can say that the precedent set was wrong. And that's what they're doing. And, as a justice, when you say, well, you're supposed to follow the letter of the law, a lot of what we do in a law is subject to, obviously, interpretation, what your judicial philosophy is about how you read the Constitution. So, if you just went by the letter of the law, you wouldn't need, justices. You just plug it into a computer and spit out a decision. So there's a lot of factors that go into this. And with what's going on now is that you have seen a shift in judicial philosophy. And now they're trying to apply their philosophy to some of these cases that they say were decided using the wrong philosophy. So it's hard to say, but I will say that when it comes to the Indian Child Welfare case, it's going to come down to, I think, either Justice Coney Barrett or Justice Roberts. And I'm hopeful that Judge Barrett is impressed by, Justice Gorsuch's legal acumen when it comes to Indian issues or tribal issues, and hopefully that Justice Gorsuch is compelling to at least one other conservative justice to keep the majority of the Indian Child Welfare Act intact. But I think it's hanging by a vote, and we'll find out here shortly. And it's really kind of scary.
So if they say they overturned the Indian Child Welfare Act, what would be the checks and balances then? Could the House and Senate pass legislation addressing the Indian Child Welfare Act, making it into law?
They did, but see, that's the point. You didn't pay attention when I taught this in class, did you?
And that was probably 300 years ago. It may not have been, you may not have educated me on it.
It was with the Baby Veronica case. And I said this when the case came out. Justice Thomas, if you read his dissent, he laid sort of the legal groundwork of how to undo the Indian Child Welfare Act. And since that time, there have been a number of legal, those that are opposed to it have taken that dissenting opinion and have challenged, the Indian Child Welfare Act on numerous occasions. And this is just the latest one. And so I'm quite certain that Thomas is going to lead the charge against the Indian Child Welfare Act on its constitutional footing.
My question is, why do they want to fight it? What is the opponent's end game, or what brought this to the forefront, I guess, would be the question.
Well, you know, there's a number of issues. One of them would be the opponents will say it's a states' rights issue, that there shouldn't be this federal legislation telling state courts what to do when it comes to, you know, child and or neglect and abuse cases. So that's one component, is that, you know, the feds shouldn't have done this, imposed this upon the states. You know, the other component is that, you know, that this, that the constitutional footing for this, you know, was incorrect. It was based off of the Commerce Clause, that, and if you read the act, one of the first provisions in it, it says that, you know, children are our most valuable resource, sort of like a commodity. And there are people that are opposed to using the Commerce Clause to justify the, you know, the constitutionality of the Indian Child Welfare Act. So there's a number of other issues. Not only that, the cases that, you know, that they seem to challenge are the ones that deal with, you know, this Native child that's been with this non-Native family since, you know, since they're infants. Now you're ripping this child away from a loving family to take them back to a reservation where we don't know what's going to happen to them. So there's a lot of that emotional aspect of that drives these types of challenges against the Indian Child Welfare Act.
I understand and I get it. I don't understand why people are so opposed. I guess I don't understand. I think it's best for any child to be with someone who understands them.
Well,
I understand how people feel. I mean, if I had a child and I raised them for 6 months and someone came to try and take them away from me, I would be heartbroken, but I would follow the law.
You know, the thing, well, and that's why people say the law needs to be challenged. It's not right. You know, but my response to those types of cases is that if they were to follow the law initially, because most of these cases, you know, where it's a result of the states not implementing the Indian Child Welfare placement preferences and sending them to wherever they want to send because it's easier. And then you get the instance where, you know, the 2 or 3 year lapse occurs where, you know, where you get these Native kids in non-Native foster homes, and that's what drives the sentiment of you can't take these kids from the only family that's ever they've ever known. It's because they haven't followed the, you know, the law. But anyway, we'll find out in I'm thinking, what is it, 16th? Most of the cases I think will be released before
the end of the year. Boy, America could just burst right open when that Roe v. Wade decision comes down.
Well, I as we've said before, I think there's a lot of other cases that you know, the court may readdress or address if that's the case. And you know what? Just the other day, it was Loving Day. You know, the Virginia versus Loving, that, you know, the court essentially struck down, you know, statutes that prohibited interracial marriage. And that was, I think it was 1966. And to think that...
Interestingly enough, a politician in the South said he would not be opposed to striking down the Loving case.
Well, you know, that would be on the table. And, you know, if you're gonna do those types of challenges to... You know, if that's the direction we're going to go, I'm telling you that there's going to be all types of cases that we've come to expect look to be challenged. I'll tell you right now,
one of the so important. That's why every Native American should be cognizant that our vote makes the difference. If you don't like the way it's going now, vote somebody else in.
You know, one of the cases I was thinking about just the other day was, you know, the Miranda case. You know, that was, you know, what critics would say was a judicial activism case. Because there's nowhere in the Fourth Amendment saying that you have to be given a warning, you know, about invoking your rights, remain silent, you know, the attorney. There's nothing in there. That was a judicially imposed remedy. And opponents could now say, look, that's not in the Constitution. We'll let the states decide whether, you know, they want to have cops give people warnings about their rights before they get arrested. So there's a number of cases that, like I said, that we'll have to revisit and see what happens. And I'm sure a lot of people will not be happy. But
and it is would what further it is. Widen the divide that there is in America today.
Well, having said that,
who's your knucklehead?
Well, I think we talked about that. You know, the politicians that, you know, do nothing when it comes to, you know, trying to figure out what we're going to do about guns.
Well, then I'll go ahead and say my knucklehead for the week is the NRA. They have bought and paid for too many politicians. They are too strong as a lobby. They are definitely my knuckleheads of the week.
Well, you have to put the blame where it's, you know, politicians don't have to accept that. I mean, they can do things. I mean, they, you know, they may have to incur the wrath of various political action groups, but sooner or later they're going to have to. I shouldn't say that. No, they're not. They're not going to do anything. But
no, they're bought and paid for. And, you know, when you're working for a group instead of the constituents who elected you, it's time for the constituents to throw you out. And that's really, in my opinion, the only thing that's going to change what happens and what route it looks like we're going on in the future. I don't think I've ever felt so sure that our democracy itself is in danger. I think it's time for these kids to wake up and get involved. What kind of world do you want to live in? Do you want to live in a world where you have to kiss your child goodbye every morning, not knowing if you'll ever see them again? Do you want to live in a world where you can't walk into a grocery store without fear of being shot or being accosted by someone because of the color of your skin? I feel like we're attempting to take giant steps back into the 50s. And let me tell you, that was not a good decade for women. It was not a good decade for African Americans. I was watching a movie that took place in 1973. You were jailed in the South for being gay. We can't go back. And it frightens me to death to see that that's the general direction the country wants to move. And I think a lot of it started when the census came out that more brown babies were born with than white babies. I think that started a lot of the fear that seems to be driving some of these groups, fear of loss of their power, fear of loss of their Christian values running the world. Well, you know, it's time to make a change back. And I think unless our young ones get involved and start standing up, nothing's going to change.
But as we know, young people don't vote. Anyway, Kenny, you going to wave that one finger at us again?
Uh-oh, time to go already. Well, hopefully we'll be back next week. You never know. Maybe we'll have a guest. Maybe we can talk Gary into coming on.
Maybe.
Maybe.
But have a happy Juneteenth.
Yes.
Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day. Early.
All right. Well, Kenny, you want to take us out of here?